All right, I mentioned Sunday. I hope you were listening. I want to give you a scripture, Matthew 24:32. So now learn a parable of a fig tree. When its branch is yet tender and put it forth leaves, you know that summer is nigh. So likewise, ye, when ye see all these things, all right, the things that we read about in the same chapter, and all of these things that we refer to mainly are in the handout that I gave you concerning the 25 major sins, 25 major sins, and those signs included the prophecies that related to Israel. The nation of Israel returning back into their homeland and the regaining control over their capital city, which was Jerusalem. But the point I was making, all of these prophecies are kind of mentioned in that particular chapter. Also in Luke 21, the same signs are mentioned. And I have them listed here in the handout. The handout says the post-tribulation view, but it refers, the main focus is the imminence of Christ's coming in the air for his bride. So that handout starts with page 11 and goes through page 16. Those are the prophecies that you're going to be dealing with from now on, and most of them have come to pass. Another one that we are hearing a lot about now is Russia, a new military power and its alliance with the Islamic world. But everything now is about Russia, and if you didn't get the handout on America's coming judgment, that was focused strictly on Russia. And Russia is going to be, I don't know whether, the Bible says watch and pray. You know, we don't want to be watching TV all the time, but we need to know what's going on and how prophecy is unfolding right before our eyes. So I have the, I know that we're busy and we don't always have time to read everything that I pass out, but it's important that you read America's coming judgment. And this is tells about all of the prophecies that relate to Russia and U.S. And if you don't have that, you really need to get that and study that, because in order for us to be where God wants us, it's going to take a lot of teaching that relate to the end time, because I don't know any other way that the fear of God can be released into us to the point where we'll be zealous of doing the things that God wants us to do. So you should have America's coming judgment, and you should have the all of the imminence of Christ is coming. One of them has the prophecies in them.
I don't have that message.
Everybody should have it. The post-tribulation. The post-tribulation, that's what this says on page 11. If you weren't here last week, you might not have gotten it.
I don't have it.
Everybody, those that got this, raise your hand. Okay. It's a handout. At the top of it, it says the post-tribulation view. But I'm not dealing with that. That happened to be on the part that I had to Xerox in order to get the numbers that I wanted included. But under that, you have the imminence of Christ's coming. And Awake, Awake, Before It's Too Late, Part One, Part Two. Part One starts with 66, and I have some copies of that. That one has been, we had that for about 2 or 3 months. All right, and last week, I think I passed out Awake, Awake, starting with page 85. And that says the imminence of Christ is coming for his bride. And you should have that. You should have the old awake, and you should have the new awake. They don't, you need both of them. You don't need just one, but you need both. And I'm going to show you the reason why in a few minutes. All right? So the prophecies that deal with the imminence of Christ's coming, if you don't have that, you need to get a copy of that. I have some copies of that now. I had them numbered up to 25, up to number 25, and I'm going to give you one more before I get started tonight. One more, that's the one probably I'm talking about now, the prophecies fulfillment.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's the one. All right, everybody should have prophecies, the post-tribulation. You need this one here too, okay. All right, this Awake, Awake, which is part two, Awake, Awake, and the handout that deals with the imminence of Christ's return with all the prophecies. That's from 11 through 16. If you weren't here last week, you probably didn't get it. All right, the other one is about the America, the America's coming judgment. That's handwriting on the wall, and you really want to deal with that because it talks about things that our power grid has been compromised, and the scripture talks about that same thing. So you really want to know what's what. All right, on the 25th, prophecies that have been, major prophecies that have been fulfilled. I'm going to give you one more, what Jesus said in Luke, Matthew, 24, Matthew 24, it says this, it talks about Israel returning back to their homeland, that's verse 32. And then it says, so likewise ye, when ye see all these things, know that it is near, even at the doors. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. All right, that is a real profound statement. This generation shall not pass until all be fulfilled. All right, the generation in which we see Israel returning back to their homeland and gaining control of their capital city, which is Jerusalem. And that happened in Israel became a nation in 1948, and Jerusalem was recaptured and regained in 1967. Now this is the generation that see Israel returning and Jerusalem under the control of Israel, and all of these other signs that we are reading about, all of these signs coming together simultaneously, and that's what's happening today. All of these things that we consider as major signs, they are happening all together. So Jesus said that when you see all of these things come to pass, this generation shall not pass away until all be fulfilled, until he comes. All right, so generation, we know, Matthew 21, all right, I'm going to show you how long a generation, so we don't have to speculate how long a generation is. All right, a generation according to the Bible. Says verse, chapter 1, 17. So all the generations from Abraham to David are 14. From David until the carrying away into Babylon are 14. From the carrying away into Babylon until Christ are 14. And if you go back and check the dates when all of that happened, from Abraham to David, and from David to the carrying away into Babylon, and from Babylon to the carrying away into Babylon until Christ, it's going to be over 2,000 years. It's the exact number. When you work it out, I can't remember what it was, 2160 something. But when you divide it by 42, you'll come out with a number like 50.3 or 4. That would be the that would be a generation, biblical generation. So if you added that to 1967, that would put us up like 2017, 2018. But you know, the calendars kind of varies a little bit, so you can't say it's going to happen in 2018 or 2019. But we do know, Jesus said that, you know that it's at the doors. It's getting close. It's coming, it's imminent. Now, y'all also read about the, in the same handout, it mentions about the Anatolia Dam. And that dam is the dam that the Bible says is going to be the way that the Bible mentions about the Euphrates River drying up to let the 2 million member army, that's China, to come over on dry ground. That's for the Armageddon last battle. So that dam has, I think, 20, Brother Holman, you need to research it and give a reporter, have all of these controls designed to dry up any part of that Euphrates that they deem necessary. So that's, I think, last month or this month, it was open for people to come and view and sightsee. That was open this month, so 2018. And that same year that the Mark of the Beast was, you know, by the European nation, you know, they have seven divisions that's bringing about a world government, and they are the ones that are going to institute all of the Mark of the Beast and world religion, everything that's supposed to be happening in Revelation. One of those seven divisions of the EU are working on it now, and they, one of them is the Club of Rome. Their task was to divide the entire nations, I think it was over 240 some nations, into 10 divisions. And the Bible mentions about the 10 divisions that the revived Roman Empire will be comprised of. 10 major divisions. It's going to be a lot of nations, but it's going to be 10 major divisions that the world will be divided up. The Club of Rome have already done that. And America is in group one, I believe, division one. So the Mark of the Beast, that is already in place, the chip. So, you know, there's a lot of different signs. And in this handout, you'll see things like, like 25 signs that we have before I come, airplanes will fly as birds. But that, pertaining to Israel, we know that Israel defense depends on is their airplanes or their defense now. So that's the thing that protects Israel right now. So they got you know, these scriptures apply to Israel, and that is true. Horses and carriages, automobiles seen as chariots with flaming torches rushing through the streets. That was speaking about Jerusalem. The desert of Israel will blossom as a rose. Understand that much of Israel was a desert up until recently, and understand that it has a huge area of fertile land. I think the Dunnisons mentioned that, how fertile and how productive and fruitful their land has become recently. And you can look at also things like knowledge explosion and science. Number five, knowledge explosion and science. And if you look up quakes, earthquakes in diverse places, you can find out that from up until, you know, they became very frequent and very destructive up beginning in the 80s. In the 90s, they became more devastating, more destructive. In 2009 to 2009, they are more common than in previous decades, plus more powerful in destruction. And if you look at it from 09 or however you want to start, up to 2017, you're going to get a number that's going to be much larger than the numbers that were between 2000 and 2009. But this is not all of the destructive things happen in our nation. You know, we know about the terrorism, corruption, the fires. I think I can't remember how many million acres were destroyed by fire on the West Coast. And the tornadoes, storms, tsunamis, I mean, it's up in the hundreds of billions. All right, so all of these things are happening and unfolding right before our eyes. And if you want to check it out and get your own statistics, you know, it's going to be very alarming, because this is a sign that the coming of the Lord is very near. But that generation thing, this generation will not pass away, that is a major sign. This generation shall not pass away until all is fulfilled. So that really put the pressure on us, because everything starts with Israel. Like when Israel returned in 48, Jerusalem was recaptured in 67, and the Bible said that Jerusalem shall be trodden down under the foot of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. They're going to be trodden down. In other words, they're going to be held under the control of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. So it was at the, he said, the times in the, you know, when the Bible says time, it doesn't mean like the same year, but it means that in that, you know, generation, something like that. So we can see all of these things are happening at one time, and that is the motivation that we have to really begin to, well, we know that evil, corruption, and all of that is increasing. And the Bible says it's going to come to its full as we get closer and closer to the tribulation period. And that's when all of the stops are going to be removed. I mean, sin will come to its full. Deception, deceit, corruption, drugs, and everything, all of that will come to its full. All right, another thing that you want to look at, on the hoarding of gold and silver, rich getting richer, poor getting poor. And whenever that begins to happen, judgment is always right in the corner. Remember Sodom and Gomorrah, the Bible says that it was pride, fullness of bread, the abundance of idleness, and the failure to strengthen the hand of the poor and needy. That's the thing that brought Sodom and Gomorrah down. And that's the thing that brought Solomon's kingdom down. His ambitious projects took away his desire and concern for the people, although he started out real strong. And his focus went toward providing, well, competition, trying to outdo everybody else, and also satisfying all of those hundreds of wives and concubines. All of them have to have their own pleasures and places of worship, and so that diverted that which should have been done for the building of the kingdom of God to foolishness and folly, which he later regretted. All right, so here, you know, it's all of these things are something that you're going to be reading about or hearing about a whole lot. But the last two I have there, the world's greatest war and nuclear with devastation. Israel, this is resulting from the Battle of Armageddon, when all of the nations of the earth are going to converge over in Jerusalem, and it's going to be so many people killed until the blood is going to be up to a height of the horse's bridle for 200 miles. So it's a real need and importance today for us to try to escape these things that are coming upon the world. And we escape by doing what all of the people that escaped judgment did, from Noah up to the time that God told the Church of Philadelphia that they will escape the hour of temptation. And they were the ones that would be. They had good works. They did what God told them to do. And also, you can read about it in chapter 3 of Revelation. That's one thing they did. And the other thing, they kept the word of his patience. So it's going to take that in every generation, because God hasn't appointed us to wrath. He don't want us to be destroyed. We're not supposed to be going down with the wicked. And I'm just going to touch on some scriptures, and we'll get back into the main lesson. But I want to just show you Revelation 3. The reason why I passed out created for good works, because your safety and your entry, abundance entry into the kingdom, is going to be based primarily on your obedience and what you did for Christ. Okay, now the Church of Philadelphia, well, the Laodicean church, we know that they were not the church that would make the rapture unless they repent. So that's the way it is. Whoever makes the rapture, we can see in all of the different churches, something was lacking, something was missing. They all fell short except one or two. But to those that fell short, the command from the Lord was to repent and get it right and do those works that he called us to do, like Revelation 1:3, which says that blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. So that's the prerequisite. You know, a lot will be lacking in our lives, but this is the time that we need to really begin to repent and really begin to look over our lives and try to get everything in order. All right, Revelation 3, I'm going to show you the good church. These churches were the churches that were evangelism-minded. They were churches that focused on works. This is Revelation 3. This is not the main lesson, this is the devotion. All right. Revelation 3:8, I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it, for thou hast a little strength and hast kept my word, and has not denied my name. So I'm speaking about the church that Jesus said that he will keep them from the hour of what? Temptation. The hour of temptation. That's the hour of the tribulation, that seven last years, which is Daniel's 70th week. Okay, so look at that. They kept my word and has not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue Satan or not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved thee. Watch this. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. The Philadelphia church was a church, evangelism church, and it expanded from the year of 17-something on up to the rapture. That would be the era of the Philadelphia church. That church will extend, you know, the evangelism-minded, those that do the works that God has called us to do. And so the works that we're speaking about are works that I just passed out last week, created for good works. Everybody get that? Created for good works. And that's the thing that will motivate you to get into the flow. Get into the flow and really begin to understand that the first thing that you're going to face when we face Jesus at the judgment seat of Christ, your works are going to follow you. All right, y'all sure look serious. All right, so your works. You just can't glad over what you're supposed to be doing for Christ, because only what you do for Christ will last. You just can't glad over that. And that's the reason why we need to be fired up. You know, all of us got different talents and different gifts and different abilities and different endowments. But God is holding you responsible for what he gave you. Some have more endowments, greater calls, amen. If they operate in 100% of that, then God is going to pay you for that. If you only got one thing, two things, if you're a low fish, if you you operate to the best of your ability, your crown will be just as shiny as the one that had a whole lot. All right, so we gotta be thinking about these things, because the Laodicean church was the church that was lukewarm. And it's hard to get out of lukewarmness. It's really difficult because we have so many distractions. Right, right. We got so many things that worldliness, television, all types of things are reaching at our attention. And we got to really begin to redeem the time, because the days are evil. So God is going to judge us according to how we use our time and how we use our assets and how we use our gifts and our talents. Okay, so you can see, when you go through the Bible and see all of those that were promised deliverance from the hour of temptation or the 7 years of tribulation. See, the 7 years of tribulation was never designed for the saints. Okay, I'm going to tell you the reason why. Because God dealt with the 69 weeks, God was dealing with the Jews. You know, up until Christ came crucified, did God turn away from the Jews? And he forsook them because they rejected him. So God, the 69 weeks ended with Christ's crucifixion And when they, you know, remember those people were shouting, what were they shouting? They said, away with him, away with, crucify him, crucify, let his blood be on our head. And have we seen the blood being on their head? Have we seen the sufferings of the Jews by the millions? Through every age and dispensation, Jews have been what? They've been tormented, they've been hated, they've been killed at the post, they've been persecuted, they've been annihilated, they've been burnt in the chamber. All right, so, but the age of the Gentiles, when the dispensation of grace was for the Jews and the Gentiles, and the clock stopped at the 69 weeks when the Jews rejected him. Amen. So God said, I'm just going to deal with you all. If you all want to receive the message or the gospel during the dispensation of grace, which was from Pentecost to the time that we will be raptured, that's the time of the Gentiles. That's the time of dispensation of grace. That's the time that God stopped focusing on just the Jews, but he began to focus on everybody, and particularly the Gentiles, because his promise to Abraham was that through Abraham, all of the nations of the earth would be what? Blessed through the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. So from Pentecost up to the time of Jesus' coming, for us, the bride, that's the age of the Gentiles, or the time that the Gentile control will come to an end. That means that that's the time that God devoted to the dispensation of grace. All right, so now when the church is removed, when the rapture takes place, then the last 7 weeks will kick in. That's going to be 7 years, which makes up the 70th year. 69 weeks have already passed. 69, a week is what? 49 years. Okay. 7 times 7 days, whatever. But anyway, 1 week is considered a 7 years. 7 years would be how many weeks? You have to multiply that by what? Well, we're not concerned about the weeks, but 1 week would be considered 7 years, and that will be the last 7 years that would bring in the reign of Jesus and the putting down of sin and the nations of the world. All right, so that's the time that the Lord said that we'll keep you from the hour of temptation. This was speaking about the church. We'll be kept from the hour of temptation. God has not called us to wrath, but he has called us to what? Salvation. That means the salvation of our bodies too. Amen. So I'm just showing you that the Church of Philadelphia, they were promised to be kept from the hour of temptation. And also, we were promised to be kept from the hour of temptation too. In your lesson that you have here, awake, awake, awake. Everybody got that? You see that? All right, I'm going to show you the scripture that... Okay, I'll just show you this. Now, let's look at page 85. The words at hand are going to be mentioned time and time again in these scriptures. Verse 11 and 12, everybody together. And that, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awaken out of sleep. Now is our salvation nearer than we believe. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on. Okay, now the words at hand in respect to Christ's return for the saints means that this event is imminent or impending. In other words, is coming in the air for the church could occur at any time. All right, those that just came in might need this particular handout that I'm dealing with now. Somebody come and get whoever needs one. Sister. Okay, you have, okay. Okay, this is the last one, page 85. Okay, in other words, his coming in the air for the church could appear at any time. And that scripture, verse 11, and now is our salvation near. Jesus is our salvation. That's the when we will receive complete deliverance. We are delivered now in spirit, and our mind is renewed, which is a process which takes a long time. But the redemption of our body will take place when Jesus comes. We'll get a new body, and we'll receive a glorified body. So the scripture says that our salvation is nearer than when we believe. And if you look at all of the prophecies that we just talked about, you can see that it is nearer than most people believe. Most people don't believe that Jesus, because when I was a little boy, they used to scare me, Jesus is coming soon. And I went out and I heard the birds tweet. It sounded like they were tweeting, Jesus is coming soon. I mean, they sound just like the sun. He's coming soon. All right. But I didn't realize that was in the 40s because I wasn't born until 1940. That Israel hadn't become a nation. Right? Jerusalem had not. They hadn't even returned to their homeland in full. All right? The Anatolia Dam hadn't been made way for the kings of the east to come over on dry ground across the Euphrates. That wasn't in place. So a whole lot of the prophecies that deal with the end time. See, we have 6,000 prophecies that deal with Jesus is coming to the earth to set up his millennium. You remember Enoch prophesied, behold, he come with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment. Amen. That's in Jude. Y'all look like y'all never heard this before. Yeah. And that was a man, he was what? He was fifth from Adam. I mean, he was way back there. He didn't have no King James Version. He didn't have saints to pray him to get the Holy Ghost. He didn't have no handouts at all. He didn't have nothing but hearing from God. You know, the angel had to what? Talk to them. Okay, but what I'm saying is that the thing is that Daniel's prophecies. You know, he even said, I believe this is in your handout. So I'm trying to kind of guide you through it, because if you accidentally don't get a chance to see it.
Hey, Pastor Hill, can I?
Yes.
Ask for clarification.
Okay.
You're in 2 Thessalonians 2, 1 through 5, mm-hmm. right? And then I'm looking at verse 3, mm-hmm. and you said, it says, let no man deceive you by any means, mm-hmm. for that day shall not come except there be a falling away first. And the interpretations, rapture and catching away, mm-hmm. overriding gravity, mm-hmm. I'm kind of wrestling with that.
Okay, I'm going to go over that, because I'm just going to, this handout, Awake, just the last one, 85, 86, I was just going to go over that. So I'm just going to go down. But I was just showing you from your other handout is that the early Christians, this is on page 12, who believe in the rapture, were looking for the rapture in their day as early as the first and second century. They did not make one statement to the effect that certain events must take place before the rapture occurred. Did everybody see where I'm reading from?
Yeah, D,
that's right, okay. We must also take in consideration that much of Bible prophecy in the early church era was sealed and not to be understood until the time of the end. So they still believe that Jesus was going to come in their day Nothing was wrong with that. That kept them on their P's and Q's. All right, but as we see here, in the church era, the prophecies were sealed and not to be understood until the time of the end. So they had no option nor no other point of reference. Now the reason why in the end time is so easy to understand these things is because we see the fulfillment of these things happening in our what? In our current events. Amen. We see history. Israel came back into the homeland after 2,500 years in 1948. Jerusalem was regained by Israel in 1967. All of this is unfolding. And we see the EU coming into existence in the 40s, at the same time Israel was budding. And all of those divisions of the EU that are going to put into operation all of the things necessary in order for the men of sin and for them to have control of the whole world religion. They're going to dominate, it's going to be politically, religiously, and everything. All of that was placed into operation when the EU came into existence. And that began, some of it was in the workings even before the 48, but they really began to come together and nations began to join it, I believe. And y'all can look it up in the 40s. And they kept joining, they kept joining, but it's going to be a 10-division world empire. Boil it down. And that's what the 10 toes, 10 toes, how many toes do you have? You have 10 toes? Yeah, 10 toes are going to be revived. Okay, now I'm going to, so we won't get far off where Brother Williams is. Okay, the Reckonings of Redemption by Rabbi Shively states that everything we Jews need to know about our future, you have this system, but everybody got to go there, is predicted in the book of Daniel. However, none of Daniel's prophecy were to be unsealed or understood until the time of the end. Few scholars or commentators have ever attempted to explore the mysterious manuscript until the 20th century. By now, finally, the hour has come to unseal the final end-time mysteries of the book of Daniel. Mysteries that no one could unravel for 2,500 years are suddenly being presented with clarity. The first 35 verses of the 11th chapter of Daniel predicted 135 different facts. Amazingly, each of these events has occurred and can be documented. The book of Revelation is a culmination of Bible prophecy and the ultimate disclosure of events pertaining to Israel, the church, the nations, and the final state of man. This revelation of Jesus to John in the early Christian era is just now being understood through recent and current international events which have taken place. All right, now this is major here. We understand clearly things relating to end-time prophecy through events being fulfilled in our day, such as Israel's return to their homeland, the rise of the European Union, the escalation of gigantic earthquakes and tsunamis, the distress and collapse of nations, current Middle East uprising or revolution, the rise of predicted world powers with atomic and nuclear weapons, which will destroy up to one half of the world population, the controversy in the Middle East surrounding Jerusalem, and the building of the Anatolia Dam, which permits the kings of the East to cross the Euphrates River on dry ground. Now, as we said down there, there are 6,000 prophecies pointing to the second coming of Christ to the earth, to judge the nations, and to rule and to reign for 1,000 years. When these signs begin to come to pass simultaneously, we know his coming is at the door. All these signs are pointing to Christ's coming to the earth, not to the rapture. When I see all of the ads point to Christmas, that comes December the 25th each year, I know that Thanksgiving is near, because it precedes it by at least a month. What I'm saying here is that there are no clear signs of Jesus coming for the rapture except for the mystery that we receive through Paul. He's the only one that had a clear-cut description of Jesus coming for the church of the bride. Jesus spoke about it, but we have more revelation from Paul. Of course, Jesus spoke through him. But Old Testament, nothing. But the coming of Christ to the earth to set up his millennial reign and to judge the nation, 6,000 prophecies. So that's the reason why it can come at any time, because there's nothing that is written about it that you can say, when this happened, then we're going to be raptured up. 2 months, 3 months after that, we're going to be raptured up when this happens. No, we don't have that. Okay, so that is the reason why it's so important for us to be watchful, because this is going to happen probably much sooner than we think. So the only thing that we can do is keep on doing what we're doing. Jobs, you don't stop working, you don't stop paying your bills. You don't stop buying food. Keep doing what you're doing. Keep making your investments. Keep spending your money, but make sure that, you're giving God what he's supposed to have. All right, so that's what I'm saying is that keep doing it, but at the same time, be dead serious about your preparation for Jesus to come at any time.
Amen.
Am I telling you all right?
Amen.
The scripture said, be ye also ready, for you know not the day, not the hour. All right. The Son of Man.
All right, listen to Mother.
Amen.
According to word. All right. Bible says, watch ye therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape those things that are coming up upon the earth and to stand before the Son of Man.
Amen.
That's the reason, that's the urgency. That's the reason why I'm pushing and pushing to get you in prayer. You want to be where the Lord wants you if he comes to what? To catch us away. Now we're going to Brother Williams' concern. Okay, we have awake up before it's too late. And we've covered the first scripture and that knowing the time. And now it is high time to wake out of sleep. This is the latest, page 85, Awake, Awake. Awake number 2, I guess you might want to call it that. But make sure you have that. We got copies here. Knowing the time that now it is time to wake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believe. Okay, this is speaking to believers. Jesus is coming to bring salvation to us. Bodily, you know, we're already saved spiritually, right? Minds are being renewed, so that takes care of the soul. But when it comes to our bodies won't be saved or redeemed until Jesus comes and give us our glorified body. Everybody got it? All right, so that's what he's speaking about. Now is our salvation nearer than when we believe. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. All right, let's go further. Brother Williams, you next, the next scripture, but let's do Philippians 4:5. Note the words at hand. Let your moderation be known unto all men. Y'all look up the word moderation on your phone. I know what it means, but I want you to know what it means. Let your moderation be known. What does that mean?
Self-control.
All right, self-control. That means if you're not under control, you won't be ready. Because if Christ is coming, well, for those that's without sin, those that have, as Titus describes it, that he came to deliver us from all iniquity and to purify unto himself a people zealous of good work. He's coming for a church that's sincere and devout, and that have no offense and filled with the works of fruits of righteousness. Filled with the fruits of righteousness. And I did give you out a handout what it means to be, well, you're created for good works. And so we need to be concerned about our works. And we're believing that our work starts right among ourselves, releasing, yielding, letting God use you, let the gifts of the Spirit work, so people around you can have more fear of God and live, seek God and get right. And that's one of the easiest ways that you can fulfill the works that you were called to do. Totally yielding, like we did Monday night. We didn't quite totally, but he came close to, and things happened. Okay. All right, so moderation is going to be important, self-restraint. That means that self-control. All right, now here's the one that we're going to focus on for a minute. Okay, let's read it first.
Nope.
1-5, everybody together. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. That's the phrase again. The day of Christ is at what? Is at hand. That means it's what? It's imminent. It can occur at any time. Okay. We want to... where do we start? Let's read verse 3 then. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalted himself above all that is called God, all that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. All right, all that's going to take place during the tribulation. The man of sin is going to make a fool out of himself. And he's going to sit in the temple of God, and that's where he's going to, you know, defile the temple, and judgment is going to, you know, come naturally on the man of sin. That's the purpose of Jesus. One of the things that Jesus is going to extinguish when he comes with the saints. He's going to take care of the man of sin. All right, now, the verse 3 is the verse that, okay, let me just say this. This writings was to the people at Thessalonica, and they were troubled, they were confused, they were thinking that they were going through so much tribulation in their day until they had taken the tribulation that they were going through to be the 7-year tribulation. They thought they were actually in Daniel's 70th week, the time of great wrath, I mean time of suffering and destruction, and you know, it's going to be so much happening until scripture says nothing that has ever happened, even the extinguishing of the 6 million Jews, that won't even come close to the judgment and the wrath that will be poured out during the tribulation. Yeah. It's going to be much worse. You don't want to be here for sure. You don't want to be here for sure. Okay. Now, they were thinking that they were in the tribulation, that Jesus had come, and they had missed the rapture. Mm-hmm. All right. So, Paul clears that up. He said, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away. Now, falling away is not the way that most Greek scholars interpret that. Most Greek scholars, I mean several of them, scores of them, interpret that not as falling away, but a catching away. A catching away. All right, well, falling away still won't hurt nothing, because there will be a falling away, right?
Yes.
Well, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Okay, now this is what he's saying. He said that many prior scholars of the past rendered the phrase falling away as a catching away. They talked about a time when the law of gravitation would be broken and men would fall away. Now that's what happens when the rapture will occur. Men, the law of gravity will lose its ability to hold you down. You will be released from that. It will be a falling away from that. Mm-hmm. A time when the law of gravity will be broken and men will fall away. virtue of the, by virtue of the rapture to meet the Lord in the clouds.
So are you saying that the falling away has, could have a dual meaning?
It could have a dual meaning, but the actual Greek, weis is the one that we highly valued when we were in school. And he translates that as along with a lot of the earlier translations, they translated that as a rapture or a catching away. Okay. In other words, it does follow that the catching away has to take place before the man of sin is revealed. Right?
The catching away.
Yeah. Church has to be taken out of the way, because the church is the hinderer, is the thing that keeping what? Sin from, and the man of sin coming into what? Into existence, and coming into their full power.
When they made that interpretation, because the Bible that gave the reference, when I looked at 2 Thessalonians 2 and verse 3, then it gives a reference scripture, 1 Timothy 4 and 1, which talks about the sin problem. That in the latter times some shall depart from the faith.
Right, okay.
So...
Well, that's happening too. All of us have this dual things happening. People, the Bible says, evildoers and seducers will wax worse and worse. And the Bible says, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many will wax cold. The Laodicean church was a church that was what? Lukewarm, right? That era was in the 1700s up until the rapture. See, there's two churches that still... in play now, the Philadelphia church and also the Laodicean church. All right, so the Laodicean church is what? Is a fallen away church, right? Okay, but the man of sin we know can't be revealed until the hinderer is taken out of the way.
Absolutely.
And the hinderer is what? The church. The church, the bride. Because we're the one that's keeping the... Amen. Things together, keeping things from going completely haywire now. Now suppose all the people that fear God is taken out of the way. You can see why Daniel mentioned in Daniel 9:28, I believe, he said that the transgressors will come for their full.
That's what we're pointing to at that point. I thought that was before the church, before the fall.
You mean transgressors come to their full?
Yeah.
Well, the Bible says evildoers and seducers will work worse and worse. You know,
it's bad now.
It's really bad, but just think what will happen if evildoers don't have no restraint. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, the Holy Spirit won't be taken away, but it will be taken, will be taken away. But God is going to raise up 144,000 Jewish evangelists, which will cause a lot of people to get saved. And you got two witnesses that will be prophesying for 3.5 years too, turning water into wine, water into blood. And they're going to be calling fire down from heaven. So it'll be displaying a lot of signs to get people's attention to turn them to Christ. But during the tribulation period, you see in chapter 7 that the 144,000 Jews, 12,000 from each tribe, they're going to be preaching, and the Bible tells us that there will be a number that no man can number that will come out of tribulation, that wash their robes and make them white in the blood of the Lamb. It's going to be tons and tons of people, millions and millions, without number, that will be saved during the tribulation period.
We're saying the day at hand is not the rapture, but it is the setting up.
Well, the day at hand, the day of Christ is at hand. That means that the day that Christ will come is very imminent. I mean, even the coming to the earth, that's imminent. But coming for the saints is more imminent. So at hand could refer to the coming for the saints, or it could come. But we know that the coming for the saints is going to appear before the coming to the earth to judge the nations and to set up this millennium reign. Amen, so.
I have a question on the 144,000.
Mm-hmm.
Are they, will they already be people who are saved and just didn't go when Jesus, the rapture came, or will they be the ones that are converted and after he leaves and are preaching?
Okay, that's good. All right, in Revelation 7, these were people that were sealed. This was when judgment was about to be poured out upon the earth during the tribulation period. And God says, seal 144,000. Okay, now what happens is that during the tribulation period is the period that God is going to deal with the Jews. Most of his focus, although it will be a lot of Gentiles saved, but during the tribulation, that's the time that God is going to put the pressure on the Jews, and it's going to be so much tribulation that it's going to force all the Jews that have rejected Christ and that didn't believe in him, that, you know, all that's going to help to bring in all of the tribulations and the three rounds of Armageddon and all that kind of stuff. That's the thing that's going to bring Jews, make them look to Jesus and come to him for salvation. So that's the 7 years that God have left to just deal with the Jews. So that's the reason why he put those seals in their forehead, and they have been called and anointed to what? To preach the everlasting gospel. And they do a good job. If you really want to see how clean and the virtues they were, 144, you can look at Revelation 14, and that'll show you the reason why they had so much power, because they were dead serious for God. And they, okay, it's very interesting, 14, it says that, and I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000. Now, these people preached the gospel, got all of these zillions of people saved, and they were raptured just before Jesus returned back to the earth, because they were a part of the entourage that landed on Mount Zion when Jesus came with all of us. You know, all the saints in all generations that died, they're going to be coming back, and that were raptured, they're going to be coming back with Jesus to reign with him, and they're going to land on Mount Zion. And that's where the 144 were in chapter 14. They had landed. They had done their job. Okay, just look at that. And with him and 144,000 having his father's name written in their forehead. Those are the same ones that we speak about in Revelation 7. And I heard a voice from heaven as the voice of many waters and as the voice of a great thunder. And I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. And they sung as it were a new song before the throne and before the four beasts and the elders. And no man could learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. These are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. All right, now, this probably virgins doesn't mean that none of them got married. I think this was spiritual adultery. They avoided spiritual adultery. These are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. You know, Christ is coming back for a chaste, you know, bride. It doesn't mean that you're not married, because you can be chaste and still be married. All right. Okay, these were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. They were the first ones that were saved during the tribulation for the purpose of preaching the gospel. They were the first ones that were saved. Okay, and in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. So that kind of shows you how devout and how committed and how holy and how committed to carrying out their mission, how they succeeded and accomplished so much. All right. So let's move on. Verse 4. This is the Antichrist now. man of sin will be revealed, but he can't be revealed until catching away takes place. The catching away takes place, and then the man of sin will be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalteth himself above all that is called God. Okay, that will take place during the tribulation period. All right, all right. Reverend, is that, does that fly with you? You still can have your falling away if you want. All right. You know, King James wasn't, Jesus didn't write the King James, you know. Jesus didn't write the King James, so King James ain't perfect. It has a whole lot of errors.
Yeah.
All right. But some said King James is the only Bible. No. If you really want to get the purest version of the word, we probably need to do the Greek.
Yeah, I agree with that.
And I got this from the Greek, the number one guy in Greek. All right, let's go further. I don't know, my time is gone, and we haven't even got to the lesson. But I have to deal with things that's gonna help us to get where we want to get. We got to get serious about seeking God. And so I just want to say that it's time for all of us to begin to take prayer seriously and start showing up, because in unity there is what? Strength.
Amen.
And so we just want to encourage, because I think that next week we want to make a special effort. Some are already fasting, some are on special diets, and things are really beginning to happen, and we want to, at some point, maybe next week, try to get everybody in prayer, everybody that we can, and week after that, we want to pull out all stops, and we'll ask y'all to come early in the morning or in the evening and try to get your prayer in every day, morning or evening. That's revival. That starts revival. You have to come. Everybody come together, unite, pray together. When I started revivals in the past, I did morning prayer and then evening service. And usually in a week's time, you would see a moving of the Spirit in a great way. All right. Now, all of these scriptures, let's do 1 Peter 4:7. Note the words at hand. What time do we have? I want to.
There's a clock right up here.
27.
Okay, since I don't have time to do the last part of the lesson, I might have a test on it. Let me get a pop quiz to see if y'all. See if y'all looked at it. All right, let's do 1 Peter 4. Here's a good one. It says it, everybody together, but the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober
and watch unto prayer.
All right, who is that speaking to? Pastor? And the prayer team?
Believers.
All right. But the end of all things is at what? What does that mean, at hand?
Near.
All right, it means it's what? It's imminent. The coming of the Lord is soon to occur. Amen. It's better to be ready and he don't come than to not be ready and he does come. It's better to be over prepared than what under prepared, if there's such a thing. Is that right? How many would be over prepared? Jesus said, well, you didn't have to do all that. Then he said, but depart from me. Which side would you want to be on? You want to be on the Lord's side, right?
Yeah.
All right. Well, the Lord is saying, the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore what? Sober and watching to prayer. All right, Revelation 1:3, at least we'll get a chance to read the word out loud all together. let's read the Revelation 1:3. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. All right, what do you see in that verse that's significant to you?
One, blessed is he that readeth.
All right, so you got to read, right?
Yeah, you got to read it, you got to hear it.
You got to read it, and what?
Hear it.
And then you got to do what?
Keep it.
That's the reason why the Bible said, let your moderation be made known to all men. You got to have that self-restraint. Otherwise, you're not going to pin yourself down and fulfill this. Amen. Amen. You just won't have the desire, you won't have the motivation, you won't have the zeal, you won't have the fervor, you won't have no interest hardly in those that you're supposed to be reaching out to in order for you to be blameless. You won't be blameless unless you perfect yourself through love. Amen. Amen. You're going to have to do a whole lot to help. I mean, y'all just recreated for good works. That's how you perfect your love. And that's how you will purify yourself, and you will be ready when Jesus comes. Amen. First thing, you want to get on fire so that you'll begin to be motivated to do the things that you're called to do. Okay, let's move on. Ephesians 5, 14.
You got that last part.
All right. For the what?
Time. Right now.
The time is at hand, right now. Right now. All right. Y'all want to call all night prayer meeting? Y'all just sit where you sit.
Right now.
All night prayer meeting. How many believe we need it?
Amen. Amen.
Y'all sure ain't responding like you need it. I'm not going to tie y'all up and keep y'all. You need to be tired of all of us. I do too, but I'm still running for my life.
Yes.
If I don't do more to get y'all where y'all need to be, my God, I'm running scared too. All right, let's move on. Ephesians 5, 14 through 17. Note the urgency of being alert, wise, and diligent. Everybody together.
Wherefore he said, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Therefore be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is.
What kind of message did we get out of that? What kind of, y'all get any kind of message out of that? A whole lot of messages, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Name one, somebody. What kind of message you get?
Being alert.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Awake. Wake up.
Sleep.
Anybody awake in here? we think we are. Awake, all right.
Be wise.
All right. Anybody consider themselves as being lukewarm or almost dead?
Great expectation to receive life.
Okay.
From Christ.
All right. Okay. Well, Brother David, we're gonna cry out to God and to make sure everybody come alive. Amen. We come alive ourselves. We catch on fire, the world come see us burn, right? So I think the ministers, amen, the leaders of the church and those that know the way, I think it's incumbent upon us to really lead out. All right. My deacon's still not over.
Hello.
Amen. Can you even hear me? All right. Walk circumspectly. What does that mean? Walk circumspectly.
According to the way.
What does that mean?
In control.
Huh?
Lifestyle.
In accordance to the way. The light.
All right, walk circumspectly. All right. Redeeming the time. So I told you that we're going to be, our time is going to come into play at the judgment seat of Christ. Redeeming the time. What did you do with your time? All right. Wherefore, be not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. All right. We're going to... leave it at that and spend a few minutes in prayer, and we'll y'all read Titus 2:11-13, because that tells us what we need to do. And the last one, Colossians 3:1, tells us what we need to do. And then, awake, awake, before it's too late. Number one, on page 66 through whatever, it tells us what to do as well. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. All right, what do you see in that verse that's significant to you?
Blessed is he that reads.
All right, so you got to read, right?
Yeah, you got to read it.
You got to read it and what? And then you got to do what?
Keep those things written therein.
That's the reason why the Bible said, let your moderation be made known to all men. You got to have that self-restraint. Otherwise, you're not going to pin yourself down and fulfill this. Amen. You just won't have the desire, you won't have the motivation, you won't have the zeal, you won't have the fervor.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you.